Hey, what's going on, guys? Welcome back to Marriage, Money, and Mindset. We are your hosts. I'm Jared.
And I'm Alexis.
And we are back for episode 7 of Marriage, Money, and Mindset. Hope y'all liked the last show we did on how to plan and invest in the stock market. Hope y'all got some value out of it. This is going to be part 2 today of the stock market that we're going to be discussing all month long for the month of October. Few announcements we want to make real fast before we continue. We want to thank the viewers for watching episode 6. If you watched it, if you haven't watched it, go back, watch it, like it, share it, subscribe to the channel. Follow us on IG as well, Marriage, Money, and Mindset. Also, we want to thank the new subscribers. We noticed a few more people have subscribed, so thank y'all for subscribing to the channel. Same thing with IG, the followers on IG, we thank y'all. And then, of course, Alex Seal, thank you again. We actually have a video that's coming out this coming Wednesday with him. So y'all make sure y'all go over to his channel and watch this Alex Hill's TPE. Make sure you subscribe to his channel as well. What were we discussing with him on that video? I don't remember. I lost my train of thought today.
I think we were talking about like the allocation.
Mm-hmm. Oh wait, is that good or bad? Yeah. That's what we're talking about. Yeah.
Using leverage.
Right. Yeah, we just. Mm-hmm. Basically, almost a continuation of the video we've already done on Is That Good or Bad? Go over to his channel and check it out. So we did some more content there as well. So today's episode is, what is it about?
Setting up our brokerage account.
Setting up a brokerage account, right? Mm-hmm. So we're going to talk to y'all. You know, like I said, last week we talked about the stock market, more of like an introduction to the stock market, kind of explaining what it is, how it can, you know, help you build wealth. And, so we dumbed that down. We want to continue that type of format. This is almost, like I said, second step to, you know, the stock market, setting up your brokerage account. So we're going to talk more on that. We talked about it a little bit on the last video, but today we want to talk more in detail about what to look for when you're setting up a brokerage, how to set up a brokerage account, et cetera, because you need a brokerage account in order to purchase or buy and sell shares of companies or stocks. Mm-hmm. So that's what today's episode is going to be about. So got the easel, of course. So setting up your brokerage, right? All right. So we're gonna dive right on in. So we have 8 steps. Well, of course, like I said, the goal of this video, of course, is to help you if you are an individual or individuals that want to set up your own brokerage and manage your own portfolio. That's what we're doing this for. Okay. We touched on that in the last video. You know, if you want to have a fiduciary, more than welcome to do that, but this is preferably for individuals who want to set up their own brokerage account. So it's 8 steps that we have today, right?
Yes.
Okay, so let's talk about it. So 8 steps. Step number 1, research and choose a brokerage, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so back when we started, you know, they had a bunch of, you know, platforms coming to market, you know, I'll say some names.
Say, yeah.
So you had, you know, your Webulls, your Robin Hoods, et cetera.
Right.
You know, so, you know, we basically went with the researching of our brokerage, making sure they're credible. Like we talked on that last episode, you know, so you want to start by researching different brokerage firms to find one that suits your needs. So we found one that suited our needs. We'll go ahead and say what we the brokerage we use. We can say that since we're saying names today. So we actually use TD Ameritrade, guys. So mm-hmm. TD Ameritrade, that's a brokerage that we found after researching that met our needs. You know, like I said before, customer service,
yes.
You know, and also, you know, having the track record, you know, of a history that shows to be credible, you know, not to mention right now, they're actually going through an M&A merger and acquisition with Charles Schwab. So it's actually going to be transitioning over to Charles Schwab here in a little bit. Mm-hmm. But basically, you know, we have a few factors that you need to consider when researching a brokerage. So, of course, you know, step 1 is looking at the fees and commissions, comparing brokerage fees, including trading commissions, account maintenance fees, and any other charges. Look for competitive pricing, especially if you plan to trade frequently. That's one thing, you know, when you're trading. Now, I think now you don't have any fees for commissions. That's one thing that a lot of brokerage companies did away with. I think when Robinhood introduced no fees or no commissions.
To stay competitive.
Right. They all decided that they were going to, you know, pretty much do away with the commissions and, you know, be able to make money other ways. So trading platforms, you know, you want to evaluate the broker's trading platform for ease of use, features and tools, a user-friendly interface, and access to real-time market data. That's important. You know, you want to make sure you have real-time stock prices that are shown on the platform that you're using. Some platforms, they don't have real-time for some reason. I'm not going to read all of these because it's quite a few.
Yeah.
You know, but anyway, guys, just make sure, you know, when you're researching and choosing a brokerage that you do a deep dive on, you know, A to Z, what this particular brokerage, if it suits your needs, right? Mm-hmm. Okay.
And also with your brokerage, there's five different types of accounts. So you can have an individual account if you just want to do a brokerage for yourself. There's a joint account that's mainly for married couples. There's a custodial account. So I think we talked about that in a different video. But that's basically an account that a guardian is over until the minor is of age, 18. There's a retirement account, and then there's a margin account.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's several different accounts, of course, that you can, you know, like she mentioned, all of them, that you basically going in, know which type of account you want to set up. And you can set up multiple accounts. It's not, you know, just one. You can set up multiple. Like, we have a joint, but we also have Roth's individual Roth accounts. Mm-hmm. So that's an example. And so, yeah. So let's talk about step two, of course, is once you find a brokerage that meets your needs, you want to complete the application. That's very self-explanatory. You're going to basically, you know, type in your social security, or if it's a type of entity, maybe a tax ID, your financial information, employment details. It's a series of questions, self-explanatory, that they're going to ask you, right? So this step really isn't too challenging. And then, of course, you know, again, if you pick a brokerage that has customer service, potentially you can call their customer service and they can assist you,
right,
you know, with filling out the application for your brokerage, right? So step three, of course, is funding the account. So funding the account, self-explanatory again, you know, once your account is approved, depending on which brokers you use, it doesn't really take, you know, I wouldn't say no longer than 24 hours tops for your brokerage to be completed or active where you can actually fund it.
And do your research because some of the accounts, some of the brokerages require a minimum.
Right.
To start it.
Yeah, that is true. So, you know, back to researching your brokerage. Usually they'll ask you to, you know, once you type in your bank information, you're ready to use a credit union or a bank. They'll ask, you know, they may actually do like a, what's called a, what is it when they deposit like two small funds?
Like a security.
Yeah, just like a security feature.
So you'll show it in your bank statement and it's just a temporary charge. Like you
not
said.
Not a charge. They won't, it's not a charge. They send you funds, right? So they send you like a couple little, like two, they'll make two small deposits and then you have to go back and type in what the deposits are. I know that's what TD Ameritrade did with us, I believe, whenever we had created the account. They just want to make sure that the bank account that they have on file is actually you. And so you just type in those two small deposit transactions and then of course they'll confirm and verify your account. And then of course from there, I think you're active, so. But that's usually how the process goes for when you fund your account, right? Mm-hmm. So that's pretty simple. So, you know, of course, you know, like she mentioned, account minimums, be aware of that. Transfer fees as well. You know, if you want to transfer your brokerage from one broker to another, like let's say if you already have a brokerage and, you know, you found out later that, hey, this actually doesn't suit my needs. Maybe I want to go over to a different brokerage account or create another brokerage account. Mm-hmm. Just be aware of, you know, maybe yay or nay if they charge you a broker fee for transferring from one account to another. So that's something also to maybe research. I know we did that. We had a small trading account with Webull when we first started. And it wasn't challenging to do that. It was easy, just a simple phone call to TD Ameritrade. They assisted us with that. And yeah, you just type in those account numbers and transfer it over. It's real simple to do. It's not very challenging. And that's why I say, you know, back to making sure they have customer service. They can assist you with that. So yeah, let's keep going. So we're number four, research and choose investments. So you want to you know, use the brokerage trading platform to research stocks and other investment options, decide on your investment strategy, and select the assets you want to buy, right? So we touched on that as well last time we, you know, gave y'all the introduction to the stock market. You know, that's very important, having a strategy in mind before you even create your brokerage. You know, like I said, you want to know, do I want a post-tax account? Like, if I want to be able to put money in my account post-tax, well, maybe I need to set up a Roth IRA, right?
Right.
If I want to put money in pre-tax but be able to write it off, maybe I need to do some type of traditional IRA, something like a deferred comp, something like that, right, where I can put money in post-tax, or I'm sorry, pre-tax, and maybe get a write-off for the year against that earned income for that year. So it's whatever you do, again, do back to doing your own research, right?
And whatever your strategy is.
Right. And, you know, you want to check to make sure the brokerage provides access to the type of investments you're interested in. Stocks, bonds, mutual funds, ETFs, or exchange-traded funds, options. So some platforms may not offer, you know, they may have stocks, maybe not bonds. They may have stocks and bonds, but maybe don't do ETFs. I don't know. So again, some brokerages are different. You may want to research that. Back to research, right? So 5, place orders. Placing orders. You want to read this one?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let me let you talk for a little bit.
Okay. So when placing orders, you can place different types of orders, such as market orders, limit orders, or stop orders to buy and sell stocks. So ensure that you know how each type works and what is your risk tolerance.
Okay, so let's explain those types of orders.
Okay.
Are you familiar with those?
So the market orders, you're going to purchase the share at what it's currently trading at, what it's currently valued at. The limit orders, you're basically going to say at what price you want to purchase that share. And then the stop orders is you want to get out at that certain amount.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's about right. Yeah. I mean, so basically, like, the stock market, once it's open, guys, you know, it's volatile, it's cyclical, it's up and down all day long.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say you have a certain specific price that you want to get in at. Let's say the stock, just to keep it simple, trade at $100 currently, but you want to get in more like at 98, 97.
Mm-hmm.
So you can set a limit order at 97 for X amount of shares. You just basically go to your platform where you can buy or sell, or buy, and then click on buy, and then it should show you different ways you can buy. You can buy a limit, you can buy at market value. If you don't care about trying to get it at a specific price, you can just pay market value.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have, you know, a certain amount of shares at a certain price you want to buy, of course you just set it up and you can just let it, you know, sit. You don't necessarily have to watch the market, time it, or any of that. You just let it basically place the order and you go on about your day.
Right.
And then if you're trying to exit the market for, you know, like she mentioned, the stop orders were basically where you want to get out. You can say, okay, let's say if the market's going up, you bought some shares and you're trading. Maybe you say, I paid, you know, $100 for this, $100 a share. Now I want to exit. Maybe the stock has risen 50%, you know, so what, that's 150. And let's say you want to get out at 150. You just set it at 150. And then there's also, like, the daily, you can set it for the day, or you can set it for GTA or GTC.
Mm-hmm.
It's good till canceled.
Good
till canceled.
Okay.
So you can have it set at GTC, which stands for good till canceled. And then of course, if you just want to leave it at good till canceled, basically it'll just sit there until the individual cancels it. Yeah. So placing orders is not that challenging to do. Some people, yeah, again, back to paper trading. It helps when you do paper trading because you can play with all of these tools.
Right.
You know, they offer that on the paper trading platforms as well.
And again, like we mentioned in the previous video, paper trading is just basically practice. You're trading the real market with fake money.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a great way to get practice.
Right, right. Okay, so 6, monitor your investments, right? Keep an eye on your investments. Track their performance and stay informed about the market news and events that may impact your holdings, right? So you want to make sure whatever you're invested in, that you are on the up and up every day, with what's going on, not necessarily what's going on every day, but you know, when we research companies, like, we're going to talk about that in the next episode, by the way, more in detail. That's actually what the next episode is going to be about, picking your investments, how to pick the right investments. Mm-hmm. So you want to make sure that fundamentally the company is sound, right? And we're going in more detail in the next video with that. And then another piece you also may want to, like, mainly for traders, but even for, you know, long-term investors, technically, you want to make sure the graph, you know, isn't too volatile. So we'll talk about that more in the other video. Just stay tuned. We'll go into detail on fundamentals and technicals on that one. But yeah, and then also just being aware of what the news, like, let's say if, you know, something occurs with a company that's causing the company to, you know,
fluctuate.
Like, yeah, exactly. Fluctuate, or, you know, potentially maybe even looking at a bankruptcy, right? You know, or just crashing, you know. So you want to make sure that you at least inform, pay attention, guys. Just pay attention to whatever you're invested in. You should, right? You know, so pretend it's your company, because technically you own a piece of it. So,
right.
Yeah. So just watch it like as if it was your own company that you created. So number seven, of course, let's keep it going. Review and adjust. Review and adjust. Periodically review your investment portfolio and make adjustments as needed to align with your financial goals and risk tolerance. We talked about that last video. That's more along the lines of
balancing your portfolio.
Right.
Making sure. I think you gave the example in the last video of two companies. Mm-hmm. If you're invested in two companies, you want it to be 50-50 weighted. So if you notice that one runs up, it's going to be overweighing the other one. So you want to maybe sell off some shares of that first company and potentially purchase shares of the second company, just so they're balanced at 50-50.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes you may be in a company where it's just time to exit. I mean, just, you know, just like I said, periodically review it. You know, again, if you're managing your portfolio, it's going to require a little bit more, you know, responsibility from you, from your part, you know, and, you know, back to what we said before, you got to make your mind up if you want to do this on your own or not. So, and again, if you're doing it on your own, just make sure that this is also something you're doing, right? And then the last step is just tax considerations, you know, being aware of the tax implications of your investments and consult with a tax advisor if necessary. You need to know the difference between the short-term and long-term capital gains. So anytime you purchase and sell stocks, either it's for a loss or a gain. Let's see. I'm gonna do something real quick. So, like, just to explain. So let's say you paid $100 for a share. Let's just say one share and you sell it. Let's say you, that's what you paid, right? That's your purchase price, right? And let's say you sell the shares for $200, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So the difference here is $100. Right, that's $100 capital gain. So that's what you have to actually pay tax on. That this $100, right? That's the money that you made. You made 100%. Now, depending on, let's say, if you held this position for less than a year, then you're going to pay short-term capital gains.
Short-term,
exactly. It's a higher tax, right? Mm-hmm. And if you held it for a year and a day, well, then you're going to pay long-term capital gains tax. So, which long-term is basically a little bit less than the short. So, ideally, you want to hold your shares at least a year and a day if you're looking at trying to save on taxes. Mm-hmm. You know, that's why a lot of traders, that's something that I don't really hear them talking about most of the time. You know, they're buying, you know, I know one guy in particular, he trades all the time. I don't know if he thinks about that when he's doing it, but we definitely do. And we've actually had, you know, to pay capital gains on short and long term in the past. So I know how that can be personally. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you know, again, guys, these are just some simple steps to consider, you know, when you're looking at a brokerage to invest in. You know, it's an important step to your journey. You know, like I said, we long term with ours. So when we got in, we wanted to make sure that, you know, we use the company that we can, you know, use for the long term. You know, right. Like, I don't know if y'all seen this movie that just came out called Dumb Money. There was a part in that movie where they talked about Robinhood not being able to pay their
investors.
Well, the people that invest on their platform. So, you know, y'all go check that movie out, by the way. It's pretty cool. It was talking about, you know, the whole GameStop rally situation. It's a pretty good movie. But yeah, again, you know, so if you're in a brokerage that can't pay you, that's something to be concerned with. So, yeah, again, guys, you know, think about that going in. Make sure you have a reputable brokerage. Again, we use TD Ameritrade, soon to be Charles Schwab, because they're doing that M&A. But yeah, so investing in the stock market involves risk. So do your own, do your research and consider what she got going on here. Let's see. Got some writing going on. Okay, so it has it involves risk, and it's important to do your own research and consider your financial goals and risk tolerance before making any investment decisions. Again, seek, you know, advice from a financial advisor if you're unsure about your investment strategy. All right. So, anything else you want to touch on about a brokerage? I mean,
well, going back to the tax consideration. So, if you're thinking about taxes, if you have a profit of $100, you want to set aside some of those gains for taxes.
Yeah.
So, depending on what you're going to be paying, if it's 20% or 15%, set that aside because you will have to pay taxes on it.
Yeah. This $100 realistically is probably going to be more like 75.
Right.
For you, you know. I mean, setting aside 25% of your gains. Mm-hmm. I mean, you'll get your original invested capital back. You'll have $200, but take 75 out of this 200 that you get. So realistically, you'll be getting back about 175.
Right.
So that's the reality. Or if you want to keep the whole 200, you'll be in for a big surprise when you file your income tax. Yeah. However you want to do it.
Right.
So we do have an exercise. So for y'all, we want y'all to, when y'all create your own brokerage, share in the comments, what type of account did you open? Was it a Roth, individual, a joint, a custodial? And also share the brokerage company that you went with. Just curious. Want to see what y'all, you know, chose. And why, if you want to mention. You know, why did you like this company? And why did you choose this type of account? So that's pretty much, like I said, this was a short and sweet video, guys. It wasn't, you know, a whole lot to go into detail about picking a brokerage. I mean, it's kind of a simple thing to do. But then again, we wanted to make sure that y'all had some things to consider when you're selecting your brokerage account. So,
right.
Anything else you want to mention?
Do your research.
Yeah. Research, guys. So,
yeah. Again, right. Like, share, comment, subscribe.
Yeah.
And marriage, money, and mindset.
Yeah. All right, guys. We'll see y'all next week for episode 8. Y'all take care. Have a good week.
Peace.